us. We bless you, Lord, this morning.
You are good, and you're worthy of our praise today, God. Yeah, just come and position yourself as we come to praise him this morning. The one who makes a way, the one who opens every door. Just lift your hands. Why don't you give him a clap offering as well this morning? We say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. Sing it again. It's who you are overall. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory.
To us, but to your name, we lift up. 2:10 says, and ye are complete in him. You are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. And I'm here to tell somebody today, it doesn't matter what you're going through, whatever you're facing, you are complete in him. He has given you everything you need to face the battle in front of you. You are complete.
Defeated by love, you overcome.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus.
what the enemy meant for evil, you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Yes, you take. You take what the enemy meant for evil, you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
High and lifted up, be high and lifted up. Now, as the worship team just begin or continue to play, could I ask some life group leaders to come out? If Sandy and Marcy, if you come out, Liz, if you can come out, just to begin to serve everyone. Anna, for your group, just take one of the trays. Janet, can you come? That's it. Great. And just continue to lead us in worship, Ryan. Just as you take the cup this morning, just keep it, and then I'll lead us into how we're going to just break bread this morning together. You know, as we've been worshiping this morning, there's two things that feel have really come out. The one was that we're going to see a victory. You know, whatever we're going through, that Jesus has made a way for us to experience a victory. And in that place of victory is the breaking of bread. This was the night that Jesus was betrayed. He took bread. And when he had broken it, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." There was victory in the brokenness of Jesus. It wasn't that he was a victim. It wasn't that he was facing the cross and thinking what on earth had gone on in his life that it was ending like this, as he took the bread, he took it and he broke it, and really what he was saying to them was, this is your victory because it's also my victory. And so why don't we take the bread and eat that this morning? Father, we thank you for the precious body of the Lord Jesus. We want to thank you, Father, that his brokenness was our wholeness. And Lord, we ask that for even that we as a body might experience the brokenness so that we can bring wholeness into other people's lives. So, Father, as we take this bit of bread this morning, we want to focus in on the victory that you gave for us by your body upon the cross. Go on, eat the bread right now. It says, then after supper, he took a cup. And when he had given thanks for the cup, he said, this is a new covenant. Tonight something changes for you. This is a new beginning. This is when everything brings us to a place of completion. And we've had that word this morning that we're complete in him. And in that place of completion, there's nothing more for us to do. So as we drink the cup this morning, you know, I was really focused as we were worshiping this morning upon the pierced side of Jesus, and it said blood and water came out. It wasn't water and blood that came out, but it was blood and water that came out. And as we were worshiping, I just had that sense that we first receive forgiveness. You know, before we talk about cleansing, we know forgiveness. You know, it's because of God's forgiveness that we can enter into his presence. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And so here, when his side was pierced, in that victorious moment, and Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, saying, this is a new covenant, it was a covenant for the forgiveness of sins. So I want you to take this cup this morning, and I want you to experience afresh the forgiveness of your God. Without the shedding of blood, there would be no forgiveness. But then blood, water came out, and as the water came out, water symbolizes washing, cleansing, the removing of things. And so let's drink the cup this morning, and let's remember that we enter in through the shed blood of forgiveness, but also we receive the cleansing of the waters. So just receive that this morning as you celebrate the victory of Jesus. Let's drink the cup right now.
Simple words with me, worthy, worthy is your name. Your name, worthy is the name, yes, you are.
You know, as we continue to worship, let's just bring our tithes, our offerings this morning. We don't need any more encouragement that this song has brought to us of just giving to Him all the praise. So just make out your offerings this morning. You know the various ways you can do it here. And let's just bring our offerings as we just continue to lift up this matchless, this awesome name of one who is called Jesus. Just applaud the Lord, can you, this morning? Just enter into that place of nearness to Him this morning. Let Him be your friend this morning. That every time we set our face to seek You, You're already there for us. because you constantly pursue us. And Father, we want you to receive our thanksgiving this morning for your precious Son, Jesus. And Lord Jesus, we give you and we offer to you all our praise. Well, find something in yourself to praise him this morning. You know, whether it's words, whether it's a clap, but just express your thankfulness this morning. Thank you, Lord. Bless somebody who's close to you. Tell them that Jesus enjoyed their praise this morning. Just receive that sense of presence into your heart, into your life this morning. Just receive it. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Lord Jesus, as you draw near to us, we open our hearts to you. And as we open our hearts, you meet the deepest longings. The parts in our lives that no one else can touch, you come and you fill up. And so this morning, we open our hearts afresh to receive more of that wonderful infilling of your precious Holy Spirit, the one that you promised to give us. And so we make a declaration this morning that you're the God who meets the deepest need that we have, and you fill us up and you complete every work in our lives that you have begun. And for that, we are so thankful, and we give you glory, and we give you the honor, and we give you the praise, because no one fills our life like you do. Come on, applaud him this morning. Ha, wow. Yeah. I'm going to ask Ryan in a moment just to come and share what he's going to be up to next week. Sharon and I just got back from Spain. We had a great time there with leaders in Madrid, and then we went to a small place called Castellón, and we spent time with two pastors there, one who is recovering from COVID and really is struggling. We were sat down having a meal, you'll know this, Richard, and his pulse rate was 125, you know, and just exhausted. So we need to pray for him and pray for his wife. But also we had a wonderful time at the Key of David in Madrid. And, you know, you could just sense the people here were praying. So for everyone who prayed for us, big thank you. And a big thank you to the Lord Jesus for showing up in the way that he does. You know, and there's a couple of other things before Ryan comes up, so we don't break into coming from Ryan into the ministry this morning. And that is, we have worship encounter, worship and prophetic night. And that's on Saturday, 19th of March, 7 o'clock here. So put that in your diary. And then following that on the Sunday, we have a bring and share church family lunch. And the last time we had one here, it was a great time of fellowship. So, you know, just encourage you to start getting things ready. Then we can have a real big feast if we take time to prepare it. And then also we've got baptisms coming up on the Passover Easter weekend. And so if anyone here has not been baptized and they want to be baptized, then either speak to me or speak to Ryan or Anna or Sharon at the end of the meeting, and we can just then get it arranged for you to be baptized. Okay, it's always a great time as we celebrate Passover, the great victory. We also celebrate Resurrection Sunday, which speaks of us coming up out of death into life. So that's on, that will be at the Passover, particularly on Resurrection Sunday. And then we've got the Passover gathering, 15th and 16th of April. So, you know, you'll be getting your invites to join the various teams on that. So do sign up so that we can be a blessing to people who come to us. We've got two great people joining us. We've got Miles Weiss, who's joining us, and we don't know whether that's going to be Zooming in or whether it's going to be here in person, but we also have Drew Keir, who just carries a wonderful anointing of resurrection life upon his life. So he's going to be with us. I think that's everything. Ryan, just come and share, can you? What you're going to be doing in Zim.
Great, thanks. What a great time of worship, huh? I mean, we've been talking about it for the last couple of Sundays, and God is activating it in our in the presence. And so I've got to try and talk now, which is great. So good to see so many people as well. Welcome to everyone. He's so welcome here. You know what? One of the biggest blessings it is when we go out on mission, and you know Revival Fires has been founded on taking the fire of revival to the nations. And it's nothing new, but we have a new country beginning tomorrow. Come on. Yes, any Zimbabweans in the house today? Come on, you guys are louder than that. Woo! So I'm going to Zimbabwe tomorrow. You guys have heard bits and pieces about it, but before we send, it's good just to tell you a little bit of what's happening and why. As you know, you know all my Africa stories and my stories of animals and elephants. I'm Zimbabwean. Why now? Something happened a couple years ago. I reached a point in my life where I had spent exactly half my life in England and half my life in Africa. And God began to stir something in me again for the place where I was born. And it coincided with, do you remember the messages about the field of dreams? About Nehemiah? See, the reason I'm bringing this up is because this is how God works. Pay attention to every message that is preached. Pay attention to what the Lord is doing in your life, because he uses it to mold and to direct your destiny. So Trevor was speaking about Field of Dreams, and one of the things Nehemiah did, he always asked, whenever someone came to visit the city, he asked them, how was Jerusalem? What was the state of the city? And I began to ask some of you Zimbabweans here in the church, other people online, what is the state of the country? What is the country? What is going through in that nation? I'm beginning to ask the Lord, what is the burden that he wants me to carry for the nation? Coinciding with that as well, in 2021, Chuck Pierce brought a word, and he said 21 is the one in the decade of 20 is a time to return to the root. So I began to pray for Zimbabwe. I began to pray that God would bless that nation. I don't know how, Lord, if you can use me. If it was just sending money, I'll do that. If it was just praying and supporting people, I'll do that. I began to reach out to leaders who I knew were in Zimbabwe. And guess what? I didn't really get anything back. So I thought, okay, I'll just keep praying. But then out of the blue, last year, in May last year, I have a friend who we grew up in high school together. I taught him how to play guitar, and he was an inspiration to me. He would preach in assemblies at school. We were both sold out for Jesus at 15, 16, 17. I'm still sold out for Jesus now at 39. We were sold out for Jesus, and he would inspire me because he would stand up in front of the school and he would preach, and I'd be like, God, one day I want to be as bold as him. And I would teach him how to play guitar, and he would probably be like, one day, God, I want to be able to play guitar like him, you know. Anyway, out of the blue, I didn't even know, his name is Donnie. He's been in South Africa, which is a different country to Zimbabwe. You're all forgiven. He was being in South Africa. And out of the blue, he Facebooked me and said, Ryan, when are you coming on mission to Zimbabwe? That was the verbatim. That's what he said. And Anna and I, our hearts just leapt within us. We're like, this is something new that God is stirring. And so we got talking to him. He's actually back in Zim. He's leading a church. Would you believe it? Let me tell you the story. When I was 15 years old in 1998, a refreshing move of the Holy Spirit swept through Zimbabwe. We were in a church. It was a Dutch Reformed church. The pastor would pray for people and they would fall down. And they had no idea what was going on with this. But the pastor knew that God, this was the Holy Spirit, and he wasn't going to back down. And the church said, we don't think this is right. You need to leave the church. And so we left the church to start a new church. Guess the building. So this church has grown so much. Donnie's the pastor of it. It's doing so well. It's grown so big that they need a bigger building. And last year, the very church that kicked them out said, our church is empty. Wow. Would you like to hire our building? Wow. So talk about back to the root. We're going back into that church. I'm going to be setting up media for them. They're in a season right now of re-envisioning the church. And I've just been so blessed being there to help them. That they're in a process as well where they really feel called to revival. Isn't it amazing how God knits hearts together? They're following prophetic words over the town, over the region, and they're really believing for God to move in revival. And they're wanting me to come in and to minister into that. One of the things that they're doing, it's a farming community, so it's hard to build momentum when people aren't at Sunday meeting regularly. So they're setting up cameras, and they're going to start live streaming so that people on the farm can also stay up to date. So I'm going to go and set all that up. Going to minister to the worship team, going to preach. So I want you to pray for me. I need a breaker anointing. One of the things we're also going to do, we're going to go right up to the border of Mozambique and Zimbabwe in the highlands. And up in the highlands is a thin place. It's funny how we go to Gangtok as well, one of the places that Trevor goes and Revival Fires go in India, is in the Himalayan mountains. And it's in that place that God gives us open heaven revelation. There's an amazing outpouring of his Holy Spirit that comes. And it's a mountainous region as well that we're going to, because one of the things that happens there is they buy coffee from the coffee growers, and Donnie roasts them, and he sells them to embassies in the city, and he sells them to safari lodges, and he's blessing and working with the local farmers, small-scale subsistence farmers. If Collins and Sandra are in the house today, it's the very village that they come from, which is amazing. So I was talking to Collins at the wedding last week, and he was telling me the chief's name. I've got to go and speak to this chief and go to pray for this chief. So I'm going on assignment. But what we're also trying to do is to set up some feeding programs in the school as well, up in the eastern area of the country. So I'm only there for 1 week. I won't be here on Sunday, but I really appreciate being sent. You know, it's so important to be sent. It's so important to know that I'm going with your blessing, going to carry the revival, the anointing that God's put in this place to go and bless other people. So that's a quick overview of what's going on.
Okay, Ryan, if you could just stand here.
You've got oil.
And where's Tom? Tom, can you come down?
And Hannah, can you come out? And Sharon, let's all stand, shall we?
Because by standing is what we're doing is identifying. And as we're anointing, we're commissioning. Come on out, Gary, as well. And we're commissioning, and the commissioning is the sending. And so what Ryan is going to do as we send him, he's going to take everything that we have here, and he's going to be able to release impartation into those areas that he's going to.
And so that's why we're releasing a commissioning anointing upon him this morning, so that he can go and take. And so, Father, we just come this morning. If you can stand behind Ryan, Gary, that's it. Father, we just come this morning and we anoint Ryan. Father, just like you said, you anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. Goodness and mercy follow me every day of my life. And so, Father, as we anoint Ryan's head, we anoint his hands. And Father, we release a commissioning upon him, a commissioning for the nation of Zimbabwe. Thank you, Father, as you've opened this door of effective ministry, because that's what it is, Ryan. It's a door of effective ministry for you to pour in the anointing of the Holy Spirit, for you to do extraordinary miracles, for you to bring down demonic powers, and for you to see the church established. And so, Father, as we pray for Ryan this morning, we release that commissioning on him in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, Father, I thank you for Ryan. I thank you that you've given him an inheritance. And Father, I thank you that you've given him the skill and the ability to be able to pour out for those people who are of need in the way to display and to preach the gospel. Father, I just speak into Ryan fire right now. We speak the fire of the gospel burning deep inside him. Father, I ask that he would be able to not be able to sleep, but just to burn. Sorry, right? But like, Father, I ask for fire. You said that revival fire burns within us. I know that's his calling, and I believe it. I speak it on you, Ryan, right now. I just believe that when you go there, Ryan, you're going to be kicking up the dust. Like, there's going to be dust all over the place. And I believe a stampede will follow. Lord, I ask that you would establish Ryan, really just like strengthen his feet, give him courage and boldness as he goes. Let him not consider the effects of his speech, because you're there, Ryan, to speak like a sword into situations, into peoples, right into their heart. So, Father, I ask that you would give him the word of the Lord as he stands there in front of people speaking. Do it, Lord.
I just saw, as you went, that all the talents and skills that you're taking with you, and God says, I'm the great economist, Ryan, and everything that you've needed in your hands throughout your life, even though it seemed to be sometimes extra to what you required, and why have I got this as well? The Lord says, I'm the great economist. And then I had a picture of like a great department store, as if you could take whatever you wanted from the department store. But the Lord said, no, actually, it's higher than that. I'm taking you into heaven's resources rooms. And whatever you need to take, Ryan, it's there available for you. Whether it's the gold and the silver or the giftings or the anointings, that you might know what it is, that whatever you need in your hands, Father is supplying.
I just have some Isaiah 49 for you, Ryan. He made my mouth like a sharp word. In the shadow of his hand, he hid you until now. He's made you like a polished arrow. He's hidden you in the quiver. And he said, you're my servant in whom I'm glorified. And I just bless you, Ryan, to go into the land of your birth. And I know that we've covered this nation in prayer for years. And I just have a sense of the Father's good pleasure as he sends you like an arrow into this place. And I do see fires of revival being started there. And we thank you, God, for what you will do. Remember that word. I see fires in Africa.
Stand next to him, Anna. And so, Father, we just release a covering over Ryan and Anna in the name of Jesus. Father, even now we just cast down every demonic assignment and we release every Holy Spirit assignment over their lives in the name of Jesus. Father, we ask that the blood of Jesus would speak for them in the very courts of heaven, and that every voice of accusation would be brought down in Jesus' name. And there would be testimony that speak of the overcoming power of King Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Okay, now before you sit down, stand here, Ryan. Before you sit down, I want you all to prepare a gift. Okay? Because we're going to bless the nation that Ryan is going into, Zimbabwe. And so if you could just get an envelope. It would be best to put our gifts in envelopes this morning, because what we want to do is we want to be able to put a seed into the nation from the commissioning. I know people have given in the past, but this is a seed from the commissioning. Okay, so get it ready. And if I could have another basket. That's a great, Sheila. Thanks. And put it in front of Ryan, can you? So that's it. Thank you, Lord. Okay, so have you made out your gifts? And, you know, there were times in the scriptures where they came and they laid their gifts at the apostles' feet. And commissioning is all about sending. So this is an apostolic operation that we're doing this morning. And so as we come, I want you to put it in the basket at Ryan's feet. Let's just start coming right now. That's it. That's good. You know, it's just a release on the commissioning. Wonderful. That's it. It's great to see people coming to bless a nation. Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Africa shall be saved.
Yeah, amen. Yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Is that everyone? Glory. Okay, so Ryan, yeah, so Father, we just ask now, seeds, so that Zimbabwe can be saved. Let's just decree that out this morning, nice and loud. Zimbabwe shall be saved. And again,
Zimbabwe.
Did you hear what he said? Ryan has already paid his tickets. This is all for Africa. So, yeah. You know, that's the blessing of the Spirit that's in this house. You know, Sharon, when me and Sharon, or Sharon and I, were going into India, we were doing a full-time job, and
And so we would go out into India 3-4 times a year in the early days, in our holidays. And, you know, it was just a great time. And also, as you release something of yourself into nations, you know, people wait for things to happen and it doesn't happen. But sometimes you just have to, like Ryan has said, he's paid his way to get there. And, you know, that's just great. So I'm going to move this here, right, just in case I trip over it. That's great. I was really stirred as to, you know, the things that are going on in the nations and all that's taking place. And I'm not going to talk about Ukraine this morning, but I will talk about it next week because we have heard some devastating stories over the last few days from pastors. You know, just to think that pastors who had churches 2 weeks ago no longer have their churches. Some of them have been destroyed. Pastors who were in fellowship together, they're in Romania, some are in Moldova, some are in Bulgaria, some have found their way to Spain. There's other pastors who are just in a place of just believing that God is going to protect them in their cities, and they're very close to the fighting that's going on. People who we know, people who have interpreted for me, getting on trains. You know, 25, 26-year-old women, you know, going down to a station, no tickets, nothing. The platform is packed, and trying to get on a train out from Kharkov, and getting on a train and not even knowing where the train is actually going to go. You know, that is tragic. You know, and in the midst of all of that, we need to be revived by the Holy Spirit. Because it is all we have. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about the spirit of revival. I want to talk about you having your spirit revived. If you got your Bibles, turn to Song of Solomon. I don't think there's a better book that we can look at for revival than the Book of Songs. And chapter 2 and verse 8. And I want God to release the spirit of revival onto you this morning. You know, it's not just about Ryan going to Zimbabwe. We need that spirit of reviving fire here this morning. It isn't for another place. It's for your space. It's for your life. And so here, listen to these words. It says, "Listen, my lover. Look, here he comes, leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. My lover is like a gazelle and a young stag. Look, there he stands behind the wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice. My lover spoke and said to me, 'Arise, my darling. My beautiful one, come with me. The winter is past. The rain is over and gone. Flowers appear on the earth. The season of singing has come. The cooing of doves is heard in our land. The fig tree forms its early fruit. The blossoming vines spread their fragrance. Arise, come, my darling, my beautiful one, come with me. My dove is in the cleft of the rock, in the hiding place of the mountain. Show me your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. Catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards
our vineyards that are in bloom. And so here, that spirit of revival. I believe that revival takes place in various stages. Now I'm going to mention three stages where you can experience revival this morning. That's what I want to get over to you, that your hearts would be revived. You know, the whole thing with revival, it is not about souls getting saved. It is not about healing anointing. It is not about ministry. It is about Him. That's what revival is all about. It isn't getting bigger. It isn't having more influence. It is no thing. It's coming back to that place where you started when you had nothing. And when He was the only thing that you were desiring, that is revival. And we are seeing in these days, things can come and go. And yet we come back to this place where we start, that God wants to revive. He wants to place His revival spirit upon us. Not so that Dudley can be saved. Not so that the world can be saved. So we can say, look what we've done. It's so that He can come like He's been coming in worship. And we say, look what He has done. Come on, give Him praise this morning. And so here, see, He comes. Here He comes. In the same way. Remember in Matthew's gospel, the ruler came to Jesus with a great need. The great need was his little daughter was sick at home. And you hear these words there. Jesus came. See, that is revival. Jesus comes. And as He comes, things change. Not because of our ministries, not because of our church, not because of revival fires, but it's because He comes. And He comes with or without us, because it's His choosing. Remember the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration? In all the glories, all they could do was fall down. And Jesus came and said, it's time to get up. And so for us this morning, I just want to cause your hearts again just to go back into a place where He can touch you afresh. You know, we've all got our goals. We've all got our vision. We've all got all of these things. But has it come back to Jesus? That's a question we all have to answer ourselves. Has it come back to Jesus? Well, look what I'm doing. And so here, revival starts. Where does it start? It starts in me. Starts in you. You know, that's where revival starts. It doesn't start in all the things that we can do, all the things that we're involved in. It starts in me. Jesus coming to me. Jesus, then the second is, He needs to come to us. So it's not an individualistic thing. It's not just for one person. God's revival is for us all. So that we're all taken in to the place of His presence. And then it starts with hearing His voice. Listen. We can have all the teaching, can't we? Of hearing the voice of God. But when did you last hear God speak to you? When did you? See, revival is that He comes. Listen, my lover. Look, here He comes. You know, captivating our senses to hear Him. Look, listen, Here he comes, being able to have a wide-eyed experience of his presence. Same as when, listen, if you're here this morning and you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus. Oh, you've come to church, you've done this, you've done that. I'm not talking about all those things this morning. I'm talking about, has your spirit been revived? Has it been revived? So that you know that when he touched you, something changed in you. And that change brought about a difference in your life. That's what I'm talking about. And so here, it's his voice. You know, God, who in past times spoke to us in varied and in diverse ways, has spoken to us in these last days by his son. Can you get me a bottle of water, please, Sharon? Has spoken to us by his son in these last days. Thanks. You know, as I was just pondering over this whole thing of his voice afresh, you know, you look, this is how easy it is to miss. God spoke to Adam and Eve. And he spoke so clearly. They would hear his voice. And yet God spoke, but they rejected his voice in favor of the serpent's voice. Don't think we're any different. Don't think that you're different than Adam and Eve. And they listened to the serpent's voice because they rejected God's voice. Oh, that the serpent would speak and we would reject his voice. That is revival. That we reject every voice that speaks contrary to the plan and the purpose and what God has for your life. We're coming into this Lenten period, if you celebrate that, great. But I want you not to go without some things just to lose a bit of weight, because that's a waste of time. Let me tell you. Or just to get you looking a little bit more healthy, a waste of time. See, revival is God speaks and we choose to listen, just like Jesus in this time that we celebrate. The voice of the serpent spoke and he said, if you are the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. And Jesus said, I've heard the voice. That's revival. Let me tell you, we can try and build it up to a whole load of things, but that is revival. The spirit of revival is we're quickened to hear his voice again. And Jesus said, it is recorded, man shall not live by bread alone. I am rejecting your voice because I'm accepting my Father's voice. Come on, give him praise. That is revival. That is that spirit of revival. God has quickened us so that we hear his voice. And when we hear his voice, there is favor upon us to step into it and to receive it and to come against every other voice that speaks to us and say that God has spoken. And because he's spoken, because I've heard his voice, I reject and I refuse every other voice. Hallelujah. And so here, how do we experience all of this? And you go into this period up to Pentecost, go back into seeing Jesus, how he deals with the different voices that the enemy brings to him. Because we're in the same place, aren't we? Or is it that it just happened all those years ago. Don't you think there is still Adam in us? Don't you think there is still Eve in us who would listen to every other voice than the voice of God, than the voice of Jesus speaking to us? We get so wrapped up in our lives and in the things that we're doing that we can hardly hear his voice. And I believe this morning I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you this morning. Forget everything else, but listen to his voice. Because when you hear his voice, something takes place deep within you that nothing else will ever touch that place. Hallelujah. And so here, an experience of continuous revival is fellowship and friendship with Jesus Christ. That is the experience of continuous revival. We need to get back to that place of fellowship and friendship, where he reveals to us the secrets of his heart. A continuous revival is a daily dependence. Hear these words this morning, church. A daily dependence on the recognition of God's voice. A daily dependence. Not even a weekly, not even a monthly, but a daily dependence where we recognize his voice. See, when did you recognize his voice afresh? Listen to what it says. Listen, my lover. Is here he comes, leaping across. Something is being awakened in them, in this person. I want something to be awakened in you. It's a daily realization of grace. Did you hear that? Grace. Because everything else is works. And we will think that to be revived is because we've done something. And because we've done it, that God, in his love or in his mercy or in his ability to pay us for what we do. But there's a realization of grace. This is all of grace. Grace started it. Grace continues it, and let me tell you, grace will finish it. God doesn't need your works. If you're to experience continuous revival in your life, you need to come back to that place of realization of grace. His grace is sufficient for me. Because God's power is made all the more attractive, my paraphrase, in my weakness. Therefore, I will glory in my weakness. Because when I am weak, then I am strong. Oh, that is revival. That is what being revived, a realization of grace. And it's a daily dependence on a revelation of God's face. Here he comes. Show me your face. Let me see you. Listen to it. Look what she says. Show me your face. Let me hear your voice. See, that will enable you to have an experience of continuous revival in your life. Then all the other things that we may do, whether it's a Passover, whether it's a Resurrection Sunday, whether it is celebrating the outpouring of the Spirit, whether it is about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, is what we're seeking in all of that is not celebrating just the event. What we're seeking is this, a fresh recognition of his voice. God speaking to us. And we heard this year at Christmas where we talked about the voices of Christmas speaking. But here, realizing his grace and a revelation of his face. Listen, the more logical we become, the less wonder there is. You can have all the logic and you can lose the wonder. There was a sign written outside a zoo that had these words. And I thought, Lord, bring me back to that place. And these were the words. The smaller you are, the more awesomeness you experience. Shall I say it again? For children going into a zoo, it says the smaller you are, the more awesomeness the experience. I wonder how small we are or how big we're trying to become. I want to be this, I want to be that. And we have all that abounding all around us. We have it in the Seven Mountain Teaching, but the Seven Mountain Teaching won't give you personal revival. It will give you a logical expression which can lose all the wonder. And yet here it is coming back to this place where we see God reveal his face. And when he reveals his face, he speaks to us with favor and with blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. That's revival. That will cause every heart, no matter where it is, whatever your experience, that will cause every heart to come to a place where they're able to see the favor of God being extended to them through his face, where they will experience the blessing of God, where we are blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. In Christ Jesus. That word said this morning, we are complete in him. Completely complete. And we try and add all these things to us. Second thing is this, the evidence of continuous revival. If we are in it, what does it look like? See here in verse 10, it says these words, my lover spoke and said to me, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, and come with me. So what's the evidence of continuous revival? Let me tell you, it's holiness of life. A holy life. And you know what we could say about a holy life? Let me tell you, it's a joy-filled life. Don't ever think that being holy as God is holy is something that God is trying to squeeze all the sin out of us or trying to turn the thumbscrews on us so that we would walk in obedience or show a little bit more joy. No, when we're experience holiness, when we've come into that place again of completeness, and we are like God. Be holy as I am holy. He didn't say try and be. He said be. Step into that place where I am. Seeing a holy life is a joy-filled life. Why? Because it is Christ-centered. That's what holiness is all about. It isn't about do's and don'ts. It's about a person called Jesus. See, learn from me, because I am gentle and meek in heart. That's being holy. Where we choose to have that teachable spirit, not because somebody is teaching us, but we have learned to recognize the voice whoever God uses to speak to us. And it may not just be me on a Sunday morning. If that's your dose of God speaking to you, find another source, because it will do you good. And so here, evidence is a holy life. Joy filled. Also, it's peacefulness in our life. See, how peaceful are you? When things don't go the way that you anticipate, let me ask you, how peaceful are you? How much agitation is there in your heart? Because that says we're not quite yet in revival. See, the agitations. Let's learn this morning that here there is a peace. The Holy Spirit comes like a dove upon our lives, so that no matter what we face, whether somebody comes in like a Rottweiler, it makes no difference, because we have the dove. And the dove is the one that has control of our hearts. Not the Rottweiler. Not the situation that didn't turn out the way that you hoped or planned. But the dove is there. And it's so easy to get caught up with our own stuff. And when we get caught up with our own stuff, let me tell you, it's one of the most blinding things that we can have in our lives. It will blind you from everybody else, so that is all you see is yourself. That isn't revival. Are you with me this morning? I want you to get something. A church in revival. A church that has a holy place. A church that's a peaceful place. A church. And why do we have a peaceful life? Because we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Not through this situation, not through that, not through everybody doing all the right things, not from everybody doing, being like ducks in a row, all lined up and you've got everything all sorted. But we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ and Him only. So outside of that, there is no peace. I was watching Boris. Remember the dancers who came to Dudley? The Ukrainian dancers. It was their Shabbat yesterday, because they're a Messianic church. And so the church came together. I was just so blessed that the same group of people that danced here all those years ago were dancing there in the midst of a conflict where even to get there, they would have been fired at probably. And here they were. That Jesus is King. Give Him praise. Give Him praise for that church. You see, that is revival. And the same person, what was the song she sung, Sharon, here? You're so close, like never before. You're so close, like never. Oh, my Lord, how I love you so. Still singing it in the midst of chaos. See, that is continuous revival. That isn't because there's a church in Dudley that they're performing to, there's streets and people are getting saved as they were then, all those things. See, that, having peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ and having the peace of God in our lives. Peace with God and the peace of God. Peacefulness. And then the third is fruitfulness of life. I've never seen an apple tree, but let's just take it a vine. I've never seen a vine struggling to produce grapes. Have you? I've never seen it working on itself in some self-help way, trying to produce grapes. I have seen the husbandman come with a pair of secateurs and cut off the old growth. Why? Because he wants it to be fruitful. And to keep those branches, it would become wild. But the vine doesn't do anything. But the vine allows the husbandman to come and to cut. Why? So that you would produce fruit. Anybody feeling cut? Anybody feeling that God is taking something, cutting something away? Fruitfulness. That's what he wants. And out of fruitfulness, it's so that we can bear fruit, we can bear more fruit, and we can bear much fruit. Oh, come on. Don't you want to be fruitful? See, that is the evidence of continuous revival. The fruit of peacefulness, the fruit of holiness. We could go into all the other fruits, but I'm not going to. And so here, the last thing, and then I'm done this morning, because I want God to release a spirit of revival over us in proportion to his word this morning. And that is the enemy of your continuous revival. What is that? Listen to what it says in verse 14. My dove is in the cleft of the rock, in the hiding place of the mountain. Show me your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet. That's the voice of Jesus it's talking about here. Your voice is sweet, and your face is lovely. Catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards, our vineyards that are in blossom. See, in order to walk in continuous revival, deal with the enemy's attraction to you. And what is that? Determine whose voice you're going to listen to. Jesus did it. He did it when he was hungry. Because it was after 40 days that the enemy came and said, listen, you're hungry. You've got a need. Your need is you need to have something to eat. See, he knows what you need. And he will come with a deception to remove you from the place that you've just been in for the last 40 days. Feasting on the abundance of his table. And he says to him, see, turn this stone into bread. And so there is the voice of the serpent that still rings out today. Let's become more aware of the serpent's voice. Any voice that speaks to us that is contrary to what God says. Do you understand? We've just had weddings taking place in our church. What God has joined together, let no man or woman put asunder. Don't listen to any other voice, because it will take you down a road that you think it will be okay. But let me tell you, that road is already destroyed. There is no end to it. It will only bring you heartache. It will only bring you pain. It will only bring you disorder in your life. We need to come back again. See, if you want revival, this, I believe, is some very simple things that we can do. And if you don't, it's up to you. Because, as I said, it starts in me. Who's the voice I'm going to listen to? And so there's the serpent's voice. And then there's our own self voice. Our own self voice looks to our own appetites, desires, cravings. And that can be cravings for position, cravings for power, cravings for. But we have to also listen to what God is saying. God has an order in everything. And let me tell you, it's not logical, but it's full of wonder. Trouble is, we don't become small enough. Because if we did become small enough, we would be filled with that sense of awesomeness for what God was doing. And then there's also the voice of our daily situations, where we listen to it. We listen to our situation and we try and make sense of the situation. You know, sometimes there is no sense. I was talking, me and Sharon were talking to Bunu this morning. And Bunu starts another 6 courses of chemotherapy tomorrow. Bunu is the daughter of Benjamin, who we've worked with, who runs Papa's House, and she runs Lighthouse, the women's project that we have in India. She had cancer treatment 3 years ago, and she's back. They found more cancer, and so she's back with chemotherapy. And we were talking to her this morning, and the one thing that she faces, situation, the first time she went through it, she didn't know what was facing her. And now she knows everything that's facing her. A young woman that will have her breast removed. And all that she's going through. A young woman who wants to have children, but her period has not come back even the last 3 years. But she longs to have a child. This is real stuff, people. And we can so listen to the situation where, like she said, Trevor, why me? And I said, Bunu, you can ask all those questions, but let us lift you up. When you're asking all those questions, let us lift you up. So that even if you've got all those questions, trying to make sense of it all, God is still there for you. Do you understand? See, we can easily look at situations that we're in and start to pick up wrong messages. I want you to get hold of a spirit of revival this morning, because that's what's needed. It's needed in your life. It's needed in my life. It's not needed here at church. It's needed in my home. That's where it's needed most. And when it comes here, it's all the more sweeter. Let me tell you. See, that's revival. So that wherever I am, there's a sense of His glorious presence. There's a force field, but it's a force field of grace that is irresistible. And I believe God wants to release that over you today. And as he does that, we can experience, and that's what I want you to do, experience that continuous revival. Recognizing his voice. That's what I'm going to pray for you. You recognize his voice. not the serpents, not yourself, not your situation, because they're the enemy's voice, contrary to God's voice. How do I know that? The cross tells me that everything is contrary. You know, if you are the Son of God, tell angels to come. If you are the Son of God, get yourself down off there. Contrary. Shall I not take the cup that my Father has given me? See how contrary it is? Realizing his grace afresh and having a revelation of his face. Why don't you, just before I ask you to stand, because I want to pray. But before I want you to, before you stand, I just want to ask, if you're here this morning and you've never had an experience of Jesus Christ, oh, you may have taken communion this morning. Communion won't save you. Jesus will. Oh, you can say, but Trevor, I've come to church and I go to church. Let me tell you, church won't save you. Jesus will. You say, well, I religiously read my Bible and I religiously pray. Listen, religion has never saved anybody. But when a person turns to the Lord, he comes. And when he comes, you know he's come. You do. You know he's come. Because he touches you in the place in your life that no one else can touch. And he causes that which is dying to come alive. That which has died to be resurrected. And that which is dead to come back to life. You can enter into a new life today in Jesus. A new life. And if you're here this morning and you have never asked Jesus to come and to take hold of your life and to make it new, I'm going to give you the opportunity this morning. And if you're here and you've never done that, I want everybody to close their eyes. And that's not so that nobody can see you. That's so that you can focus on no one else but this question. Have you received Jesus Christ? And somewhere in your life you feel that you can't answer that question with a yes, I want you to raise your hand. Anyone here this morning? You're saying, Trevor, I need to ask Jesus to come into my life. Anyone here? Okay, why don't everyone stand? I want to pray. I was going to ask people to come out to the front, but I just feel a real check. Because it's not about me praying for you. It's about you opening your life afresh to the one who can revive you. So place your hands on your heart. Oh, that spirit of revival. Lord, where you take the embers that have died down and you blow upon them. Blow that reviving spirit upon everyone here this morning to just receive it. Just receive it. Father, I pray that everyone would experience continuous revival, recognizing your voice realizing your grace afresh and having a revelation of the preciousness of Jesus. Just receive that right now as an impartation. I don't even ask you to go away from here and read your Bibles every day. I want you to go away from here and learn to hear God speak His voice. Before we had a Bible, let me tell you, before we had a book that we could read, there was a voice that spoke. Let's come back. Let's be a hearing community, not a reading community. Have you got that? A hearing community, not a reading community. See, you can read your Bible on your own, nobody else there, but you can't listen for His voice on your own, because when He comes, you're no longer on your own. He's there with you. So, Father, I pray for everyone here that this will be a week where they step into that spirit of revival and they hear your voice. And then would you show them your face? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Give the Lord a big clap, can you? Listen, over the last 2 weeks, we've had lots of joy with families getting married and wonderful things like that with James and Sam and Lauren and Luke. But we also had people who passed away too. There's Eileen and Abe's mother passed away just a week or so ago. And there's also Caroline, whose grandmother passed away this week. And so there's still needs that we have. Also, there's people who struggle with sickness. And this morning, having released that revival spirit over you, it's what you do with it now. But if you're here and you need someone just to lay hands on you, pray for you, just release God's grace over you. There's a new recognition of his grace on your life. What was the word I used? Just so, a new fresh realization of His grace. Then why don't you come down to the front as we draw our meeting to a close? There is coffee. But let's not break out of what God is doing this morning. So if you have a need, come to the front. Somebody will pray for you this morning, lay hands on you. Jesus came, and we want to come for you.